This is the story of a musical migration, unfolded over many generations, many journeys. It's taken me from Scotland to the northern part of Ireland as I've explored an enduring musical relationship. I followed in the footsteps of 17th century Scottish migrants whose traditions became a vital part of the music of Ulster. Their descendants would become migrants again 100 years later, when up to a quarter of a million Ulster Scots left Ireland for what they hoped would be the promised land, America.
Brother, take this warning. Don't let old Satan hold your hand.
They would leave their mark on religion, politics, education, and on a new nation's democracy. But I'm here to trace and to celebrate their influence on what I would consider to be one of America's greatest gifts to the world, the music.
I'm on my way to Canaan's land, where the soul never dies, and there will be no parting, and where the soul of man never dies. Dear friends, there'll be no sad farewell, there'll be no tear dimmed eyes, where all is peace and joy and love, and the soul of man never dies.
Granny always said that we came from the border country. She said, but you know, they loaded us up on a ship and shipped us off over to Northern Ireland and wanted me to find that on the globe. So I went looking for Northern Ireland, A-R-L-A-N. Never found it. Finally, Daddy said, looky there. It's right next to England. It's cool.
I'm on my way to that fair land where the soul of man never dies, and there will be no parting, and where the soul of man never dies. Dear friends, there'll be no sad farewell, there'll be no tear dimmed eyes, where all is peace and joy and love, and the soul of man never dies.
That was great.
WSM Nashville. Now from America's Music City.
WSM Nashville.
I got a feeling of the blues. Oh Lord, sent my
blue moon. Keep on shining bright. She's gonna bring me back on my baby tonight. Blue moon.
The Hall of Fame, Nashville, Tennessee.
I've sailed my ship alone. With all the dreams on.
Every year, hundreds of thousands of visitors from all over the world come here to pay homage to country music's brightest stars.
Good
many of whom have Scotch-Irish roots.
I had a friend named Ramblin' Bob.
The taproot of this music is deep enough to go back centuries, generations, across seas, across continents.
Jolene, Jolene. Jolene, Jolene.
Whether it's rock and roll or bluegrass or country music, one way or another goes back to old-time Appalachian music.
Oh, can the circle be unbroken by...
The contribution of those who came from Ulster can never be taken away. It's a foundational element.
I saw the light, I saw the light. No,
the first layer of the music that would be built upon by successive generations.
Concerning a great speckled bird.
It's part of a continuous line, you know. It's tradition is a step-by-step process. Is it important? It's beyond that. It's just part of its fabric.
But I've come here to look behind the rhinestones in search of a forgotten treasure from country music's earliest history.
This is a relic of an epic migration, carried here to America by one of the hundreds of thousands of people who left the north of Ireland during the 18th century.
It sang to the Southlands in the hands of one of America's earliest radio stars. It was played on country music's very first hit record.
Ah, if only this fiddle could talk. I bet it could tell great stories of its life here in America. Tales of restless pioneers, of slavery and civil war, of a Great Depression and of a Grand Old Opry. But it might tell another story too, of a trade in strangers and a dream of liberty.
Our ship it is lying on fair Derry Harbour, just waiting to take us safe over the main. So heaven be our pilot, aye, and bring us strong breezes till we reach the green fields of America. Come to the land where we will live happy. Don't be afraid of the storm or the sea. For it's when we get over, we will surely discover that this is the land of sweet liberty.
I just love that song, The Green Fields of America. It's the story of a wayfaring Ulsterman way back in the 18th century. He most probably would have made landfall right here, as so many others did, in Philadelphia, the city of brotherly love.
These Ulster settlers knew all about mobility and change. Mostly Presbyterians, many of them had suffered economic hardship and religious discrimination. Migration from Scotland had happened within living memory. They knew what it meant to call more than one country home.
Though they referred to themselves as Irish, when they came here to America, they got a new name. They were known as the Scots-Irish. Although nowadays, we'd call them the Ulster-Scots.
They came looking for land and freedom. Philadelphia was just the starting point for the road to the frontier.
Right here on this very street was where their American adventure really began.
These are two of America's finest country gentlemen. Their family stories are part of that great migration from Ulster and Scotland that helped shape America's music.
The first Douglas came in through Philadelphia and was put on a wagon road south in about 1748. They loved to drink, they loved to dance, and to play music, is what I've heard for about all of the Douglases back before me.
My mother was a Thompson, my grandmother was a Ferguson. Our whole life was built around music. If you see a piece of beautiful fabric that American music is, the fiddle tunes, the lyrics of the songs, the old hymns, that red thread that's in there, and you can see it so plain, to me that would be Scots-Irish music.
My grandfather, I know, was a fiddle player, and I think his father was a fiddle player. So it goes back at least 150 years in this country. So I can only imagine that it went back further.
tough world that these Ulster-Scots immigrants came into. Most of the land they went into was covered with oak trees and elm trees and nut trees, and you had to cut them down. It was a rough place to be.
I think one word that may describe these settlers is perseverance. But it was indeed a hard life, not exactly like it was portrayed by some of the agents back in Ulster or the Old Country who were trying to sell opportunity in America, the land of honey. And it was in some ways, but it was also a much harder life than they ever could have imagined.
The promised land wasn't what they expected. One settler wrote to his brother that there was nothing here but trees and a wheeing of engines. The first settlers from Ulster came to the Pennsylvania backcountry in 1719. They named their settlements for the homes they'd left behind in Ireland. And as they tried to make sense of their new lives in this harsh land, they clung to familiar traditions and the old ways of worship. By 1721, in a log cabin on this site, they had built a Presbyterian meeting house.
Presbyterian Church really was the center of their lives in those days. That was their educational institution, the focal point of their religion. Their whole worldview revolved around the Presbyterian Church. And the musical tradition was extremely important. The early Presbyterians believed in worshiping God with the tools that were provided in the Old Testament, which means the Psalms of David.
When they first got here, they were isolated, culturally isolated. The Scots-Irish were distinctive in holding to the old Scottish Psalter, and they fought over that if anybody tried to come in and sing something differently. It's an icon of Scots-Irish culture.
The faith of their Scottish forefathers helped them define their new community as the sons and daughters of Ulster became American pioneers. Beholden to no one, they came to embody the spirit of an age of revolution. The children of those first settlers headed south to where land was cheap and plentiful, and they were joined by waves of new immigrants from Ulster.
Music has taken me down many, many roads in my life, I can tell you. But this road that I'm on today winds its way through thousands of years of history.
A natural corridor that stretched from New England to the southern Appalachians. This was once known as the Warrior Path, a Native American trail that in the 18th century became the settlers' great wagon road. Cutting through the mighty Shenandoah Valley, the wagon road and the routes that grew from it brought the settlers south and west.
Countless migrants from Scotland, Ulster, and their descendants would have travelled this road before me. And I suppose their stories and their journeys have become a part of the legend of this historic highway.
And one of these journeys has been reimagined by my old pal, bluegrass musician, Tim O'Brien.
I'm one of the few, I'm proud to be standing. I walked up the pier from the coffin ship's landing. My clothes are just rags, no use for this weather. But my back was strong, my hands tough as leather. I climbed these hills till I came to the spot where I stand. Cleared these fields and I pulled up the stumps with my hands. No more wandering, no more refugee. A mountain deer
actually consciously trying to write songs that dealt with the immigrant experience in my home state of West Virginia.
I took a Cherokee bride. She gave me five babies, and I sang at their wakes, and I cried at their weddings. I taught all my children the songs of my youth.
You can imagine someone fleeing oppression, either, you know, religious persecution or taxation or just some kind of getting away from a landlord or any kind of thing like that, and going to the new land and making your own thing, you know, just building it with your own hands, clearing the field, and then having your new family and showing them everything around here is yours and you don't need to bow down to anybody.
The mountain here is always free. No kings or landlords to treat us like beggars and thieves. No one but God here to fear.
Every year, musicians and music lovers gather at Mount Airy to celebrate the traditional music of North Carolina. The old tunes still ring out round the campsites, just as they must have done along the wagon road long time ago.
I imagined it a lot because my family came down that wagon road all the way to North Carolina. I think music was incredibly important because it was something everybody could unite around. Everybody understands music, and everybody understands the community feeling that it builds. That was how people entertained themselves back then. There was no other thing really to do except maybe tell stories. So music was incredibly important.
My long willing sail on board with you.
As pioneers, traveling with a fiddle or something small like that, it was a way of just bringing some joy to your heart after a long day or after sorrow or whatever, you know. Joy kills sorrow, you know. If you're joyful, you're not going to be sorrowful. Those two things can't live in the same moment.
We'll preach it.
In November 1736, the Virginia Gazette carried what may well have been the first reference to country music in America. Some merry disposed gentleman from Hanover County, who must have been of Scots or Ulster-Scots descent, announced their plans to celebrate St. Andrew's Day with a festival of music, a great fiddling contest.
The prize was to be a Cremona fiddle, and it would be competed for by any amount of country fiddlers. And isn't it nice to think that 250 years down the line, that country fiddling tradition is still alive and kicking in the Blue Ridge Mountains?
The fiddle built community. It certainly did on the crossing, on the boats coming over, and in the gatherings along the way. And in the midst of hardship, the fiddle was at the core, I think, of sustaining and building community.
Back home, we call this tune the Fairy Dance. I've known it all my life. But to Virginia fiddler Eddie Bond and his friends, it's known as Old Molly Hare. When this old Scots tune came to America, it didn't just acquire a new name. It got words too.
Old Molly Hare, what's doing there? Running down the road just hard like fair. Step back, daddy shot a bear. Got him in the eye and never lost hair.
Do you
It was the hot new instrument of this new republic. New styles of playing instrumental music, a new repertory, a new world. It was an amazing revolutionary symbol. Of course, some religious people found it troubling and problematic, and so the fiddle has this dual role, you know, powerfully important to many people, but also scary and maybe evil to others, you know, associated with drinking, carousing, unruliness. So it had this dual character, as the community did. Both good and upstanding and a little wild and dissolute, all at the same time. And without the fiddler, no dance.
Dances that came with the Scots-Irish settlers, they would refer to them as jigs. And back then, jig did not mean succinct time, it just meant a fast, lively dance. They also did reels that could be done in a small cabin or a tavern or whatever. And those are really the basis for our Southern square dances that developed later on.
Dance was hugely important in society at the time. And when your people from different worlds come together in the same physical community, the dance helps to seal that physical community as a spiritual community, because when you're dancing together, you're meeting and getting acquainted, and you're really functioning together.
The dances that developed in frontier society grew out of many different traditions. European, Native American, and African too. America was a cultural melting pot, where the Scotch-Irish were just one people among many. And as they encountered different musical cultures, their own music began to change too. There's no finer example of different traditions coming together than this. The musical conversation between the fiddle and the banjo began at least 200 years ago.
There's a lot of rhythm and wisdom in the banjo. Fiddle can imitate it or join in with it. And those two rhythms together are incredibly powerful. The hybrid of those two things just made this rock and dance music that really had never been heard before. When that African-American influence got in there, just sent it into overdrive.
Where'd you get your whiskey? Where'd you get your dram? Where'd you get your whiskey? Up and down in Rockingham. Let's come on home, sing, 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 come on home.
The American banjo began life as the banjar, a folk instrument with the deepest African roots. Africans introduced a totally new approach to rhythm and melody, and they had a huge impact on America's developing musical culture.
Music was helping to connect the culture across racial lines. It's harder and harder to treat a person as a kind of a non-person when you see them making music that makes you lift up your feet and dance. That's what happened with African music, banjo being a key part of it.
Thank you. Merci beaucoup. Yeah.
Music is always a two-way street. White musicians fell in love with the banjo, but African musicians also began to play European fiddles, finding new ways to play the old tunes that had crossed over from Scotland and Ireland.
Around about the time of the Revolutionary War in the United States, half of the fiddle players in the South were African American. So there was a tremendous sharing of traditions. They were picking up the fiddle and the tunes, but they were playing it in a way that recalled their instrumentation on the banjo.
You might have a tune that sounds kind of like the chords of an Irish tune, but yet it has kind of the bluesy slides and inflections of what you might find from African-American practice. I could just show you very quickly what one of these would be like. So this is a tune that's called Midnight.
The basic music track of Appalachian music started with the Scots-Irish. But then it became a tapestry and an even richer story of many other ethnic influences.
Just like their music, the Scots-Irish were changing too, adapting to meet the challenges of life on the frontier and forge a new American identity for themselves and their children.
But in that century of restless, continuous migration, an awful lot was lost. Whole family histories, the stories of who they were and where they once belonged, were forgotten.
But thankfully, some clues were written in stone. In this kirkyard at Old Waxhaw in South Carolina, there are some very unique grave markers, the earliest surviving art of British settlers in the Carolinas. Between here and Pennsylvania, there are at least 1,000 similar stones.
I discovered who the carvers were, the family named Bigham, B-I-G-H-A-M, Bigham, who arrived in Pennsylvania and began carving by 1738. In fact, I was even able to take it back to County Antrim when we searched over there to see if we could find the antecedents of these stone carvers. It seemed to be that Larne was the source area.
This is a stone from the Bigham workshop. It says here, in memory of John Crockett, who died December 16th, 1800. But if you look round the back, it would seem that our dear Mr. Crockett was actually born in a ship on the way here in the year 1730.
But I am in the house of God, like to an...
Many of the stones feature the metrical psalms from the Scottish Psalter of 1650.
My confidence forever hath upon God's mercy.
I've held the actual Psalter from 1650 in my own hands, and to see words from it carved here in stone by the hands of an Ulster man is a very powerful thing indeed, I can tell you. What a long, hard journey they must have made to get here.
But the challenges of life on the frontier made it harder to hold on to the old world and the old ways of worship.
It had a lot to do with the stresses of life in the backwoods and of making a new identity in a place where you had people scattered over these wide territories and moving so much. So the music reflects all this change and these shifts in identity.
You must be born again. It was a simple message, but a powerful one. Many Presbyterians experienced intense religious revivals that inspired a freer and much more emotional expression of faith. Thousands came together along the frontier at great outdoor gatherings that became known as camp meetings.
The first one of these took place in Kentucky, and it was called the Great Revival. And it was held outside of a Presbyterian meeting house. But the ministers who were involved represented Baptists, Presbyterians, and Methodists. And so the idea was not to emphasize church doctrine, but rather to emphasize the religiosity, the sacredness of the events, and to get people really to experience, the power of God or the power of Christ.
Their God, the Son, forever reigns.
Thousands came seeking salvation, and music would play a central and very powerful role in these great gatherings.
What you're talking about is basically Woodstock of the 18th century, right? But obviously it's not Woodstock and it's a religious event. So what do you do with 20,000 people and you want them all to do the same thing and there's no books and you can't even guarantee that the people are literate? So you have to come up with something else.
They discovered that if they sang songs with repeated lines, "My Lord, what a morning, my Lord, what a morning, my Lord, what a morning when the stars begin to fall. Rocks and mountains, they won't hide us now." You could pick it up from that point on.
All the mothers want to go. They want to go up to heaven and experience God. Okay, that's the first verse. So what do you do for the second verse? Well, instead of mothers, let's do fathers. So it's all the same words except fathers. And then what do you do for the third verse? Well, let's do sisters. Fourth verse, brothers. And then fifth verse, everyone.
Be
So the camp meeting tradition really emphasized the idea of emotion and the power of emotion and communicating with the personal role that religion could have in people's lives.
The experience of singing these simple hymns became part of everyday life throughout the South. Something that would have a profound impact on the development of modern popular music. In the early 19th century, the desire to improve congregational singing led to the development of a uniquely American tradition, shape note singing.
This music has never been owned by any particular congregation or church. People are free to get from what they get from it. That varies by the person. So there's no one telling them that this is how you have to believe.
I am a poor, wayfaring stranger, while journeying through this world of woe.
We're singing for ourselves and for God. We're not singing for an audience. When we're singing, we're seeing each other's faces. And there's a type of bonding and fellowship in that singing, just as there is with people when they gather and break bread together.
I want to wear a crown of glory when I get home to that good land. I want to shout salvation's story in concert with the blood-washed band.
We start the music with a note, not with a rest, and so we will start singing the laws with our arm is headed down. There. About two-thirds of the way down. Not all the way up, not all the way down, but about two-thirds of the way down, about 4 o'clock.
Shape note singing was designed to help those who couldn't read music. It was a simple system where the notes were represented by geometric shapes which anyone could follow. Singing schools became very popular, and soon song leaders began to produce the first shape note songbooks, the most popular of which was called the Sacred Harp.
The shape note books are anthologies of a great variety of music. So the tune books compilers, who were self-taught musicians who went to the little singing schools and learned how to do it, and then compiled the books and wrote pieces and took in things they knew from oral tradition.
It really was a popular music. The story is that in the decades around the Civil War, the Sacred Harp was the book most often found in Southern homes outside of the Bible.
The Sacred Harp was also, of course, a way of describing the human voice. For believers, it was God's gift, their first and best musical instrument.
Certainly among the Scots-Irish, we have song leaders, and one of the most prominent in this area was William Walker, who is known to history as Singing Billy. And he was a song teacher, and he went from town to town teaching people how to sing secular hymns in worship services.
When he was 18, William Walker wrote his first song, supposedly, called Solemn Call. He ran a bookstore in Spartanburg, and he also worked for the Spartanburg newspaper called the Carolina Spartan. So it's kind of interesting when you can find little blips from newspapers back then where he has ads for his books. This thing that says, you know, just out, best book ever, buy it, you know, this kind of thing, which I think I have for you in the handout.
Singing Billy drew his source material from popular culture, the songs and tunes he'd grown up with, and it struck a chord. His songbook, The Southern Harmony, sold more than 500,000 copies.
William Walker said, you know, why should the devil have all the good tunes? We think of this music now as traditional historic music. At the time, it was popular current music. Songs of the day, many of which were fiddle tunes, many of which were perhaps played by a fifer, or even ballads, these songs that were in the air, were good musical material to arrange with harmony parts and to set to hymn texts.
Pop and tradition were not separate categories of music at that time. It was just all music. So whatever was a good source of a tune, whether it was from a ballad singer or from, you know, a piece of sheet music, it was all fair game.
Let every heart play.
This is coal mining country, central Appalachia, on the border between Virginia and Kentucky, where old-time religion is still strong. When the Scots-Irish pushed on into new territory like this, where Presbyterian ministers were in short supply, many among them turned to the Baptist Church.
I often kneel with friends and pray, old time.
Traditional Baptist congregations here still hold on to the old way of unaccompanied singing in their worship.
Was grace that taught my heart to fear? Was grace that taught my heart?
This musical tradition reaches back to Presbyterian psalm singing.
And grace my tears.
To old tunes and folk songs and the revival choruses of the camp meetings. At its heart is a powerful singing style that has shaped the voices of generations of country singers.
And grace will lay on. The Lord has promised good to me. Most of them old-time song, Amazing Grace, if you sit down and just go through that and look at it and read it, it'll tell you about a man that's went through a travel from nature to grace. That the love, when you're born again, God borns you with his love. Working in the old coal mines, my heart would get so heavy, I was troubled up. When I gave it all into God's hand, God made a new man out of me. Some people says, well, you ain't got no music. Yes, when God blesses his service and the whole crowd to sing, you ought to hear the music, the spirit, yeah. Beulah Lane, I'm longing for you. And someday on the Austin, there my home will be eternal.
The vocal style, that is an identity marker.
Beulah Lane.
It's not a sweet tone, it's a strong tone. That may come from that Scots-Irish tradition. The Ulster singers brought a kind of stronger, harsher tone with them, and that pleased a lot of people, and a lot of people picked it up or retained it. That vocal style is one of the things I love best in the music.
Beulah Lane, I'm longing for you. Sweet Beulah Lane.
As well as sacred songs, the centuries-old ballad tradition of the Scotch-Irish was strong in these mountains. Great story songs of murder and revenge, love and loss, were part of everyday life. The woman who sang them, for their children and for themselves, became the guardians of a living tradition.
Come all you fair and tender ladies, take warning how you court young men.
Old Blackjack David came riding by, whistling so merrily.
To get a sense of who they were and what they were thinking, what they were feeling, we have the tunes and we have the songs.
In Scarlet Town, where I was born, there was a fair maid dwelling.
These are not museum pieces. These are not relics from the old country.
They called her Barbary Allen.
The songs speak of things remembered. The songs speak of things hoped for.
Oh, if I leave my house, carpenter, and sail away with ye, what will ye have to maintain me upon when we are far away?
They are the legacy of those who came before, both in Scotland and in Ulster, They come out of the lives of people who are now in America, but they had had experiences back in Ireland, just as their great-great-great-grandparents had had experiences in Scotland.
It's been a year since last we met, and we may never meet again. I have struggled to forget, but the struggle is in vain.
For the mountain music of Appalachia became the wellspring from which so much American music would draw. And the songs were at the heart of it.
In the midnight on the seas, his bright smile haunts me still.
They've been shared and celebrated all over the world by North Carolina folklorist, musician, and seventh generation ballad singer Sheila K. Adams.
Haunts me still, I have sailed.
The community itself had this wealth of old songs, and each person knew their 10 or 15, and then somebody else might know 20, but my granny knew over 100 themselves. And Granny's sister Barzil was just, she must have known 500 songs.
That's amazing. And did your grandmother ever talk to you about where these songs came from?
She always said they came from across the big pond in the home place, if you can believe that.
Tell me a little bit about your family connection to Scotland and Ireland.
My family came out of like Port Stewart, Coleraine, and I think it was like Omagh or Armagh.
There's both.
Well, they could have, are they close together?
Not that far.
Okay. Well,
nothing's very far from anything in Ireland.
That's right. But she said the majority of us came from Northern Ireland.
Why were the songs so important to people here in this area?
Well, I got to study a lot about that because I couldn't figure out why these old women had remembered all these songs. And so one day I said to Granny's sister, Barzil, okay, so you had how many children? She said, well, 15, 13 living. Barzil was left in that what they called a 10 by 10, which was a 10-foot wide, perfectly square log cabin with 13 children under the age of 18.
Yeah. Who all need entertained.
Wouldn't you have sung about spirits and sprites and ladies and white knights if you had had a choice? Yeah. A lot of those kids learned the ballads just that way because their mother sang them. If I had the wings of an angel, you know, they were always thinking about ways to get away from them little 10 by 10s with all those kids in them.
Yeah.
That's why I think they survived. And they told stories, great stories.
Yeah, and you're still singing to this day.
I'm still singing them, yep. I just fell in love with them too, Phil. There was something about them that reminded me, I mean, think about all the loving hearts that carried these songs across the ocean.
Thank you.
town. Save Dinah for the night. Save Dinah for the night. Save Dinah for the night.
These songs endured not just because they reminded people of who they were and where they had come from, but because they expressed deep human emotions. They spoke truth to people about their experiences, whether on the journey across the ocean or through the trials of life.
WSB, the voice of the South, radio phone broadcasting station.
As the 20th century dawned, the music, which had sustained and helped define those isolated rural communities for so long, would come down from the mountains. The new medium of radio would now carry the music to a national audience and make it the voice of America. March 16th, 1922. WSB Atlanta made the first ever radio broadcast in the South. A Scotch-Irish mill worker and part-time moonshiner became the first musician to play country music on American radio. His name was Fiddlin' John Carson.
Hello, John, how's your cat popping today?
Fine as frog hair. Run 90 gallon last night, just as good as Sal ever smacked her lips on.
That historic broadcast made him a star in the South, and in 1923, he made his first record with New York talent scout Ralph Peer. Plume, Perfect, Awful was Peer's verdict on the songs Carson recorded for him in Atlanta. But the record company released them anyway.
When the first 500 records sold out, a local agent called Peer and he told him he had a riot on his hands and he demanded 10,000 more. So they put Fiddlin' John on a train to New York where he would make a proper studio version of what had now become the first hit record in country music history.
Oh, the chimney's falling down and the roof is all caved in, letting in sunshine and rain. And the only friend I have left is this girl of mine and a little old log cabin in the lane.
Almost a century later, the song that made a Scotch-Irish moonshiner a pioneer in American music history is still a folk and country standard. Half a million people bought this record. John Carson had changed everything. He'd shown the world there was money in this hillbilly music.
Oh, I don't have long to stay here, what little time I've got. Want to rest content while I remain. Till that you call the stop and me to find a better home. And a little old log cabin in the lane. Oh, the chimney's falling down and the roof is all caved in, letting in the sunshine and the rain. And the only friend I have left is this good old dog of mine. And a little old log cabin in the lane.
Bristol, a town with one foot in Virginia and the other in Tennessee, calls itself the birthplace of country music. The street names here honor the town's place in American music history, harking back to the summer of 1927. Ralph Peer, that same New York talent scout who struck gold with John Carson, came to Bristol looking for another hillbilly hit. He wanted to tap into a deep vein of American folk music, and the country around Bristol was full of musicians and singers, steeped in the same Scotch-Irish musical culture that had produced John Carson.
Once I had a sweetheart.
In a makeshift studio over an old hat factory, he recorded Jimmy Rogers, the singing brakeman, who fused hillbilly music with the blues he'd learned from black musicians.
His loving eyes were blue.
Peer also recorded the treasured songs of a mountain family, and America fell in love with the distinctive voice of Sarah Carter.
Sing, old girl, sing, old girl, she's going just fine.
The Carters became the first family of American folk. Many believe those Bristol sessions were country music's big bang moment. But it was John Carson who lit the spark. It was his success in 1923 that inspired a generation of working men and women to see their musical heritage as a way to escape from poverty.
If Fiddle and John could do it, well, they might just have a go themselves. That's what brought the Carters and Jimmy Rogers here to Bristol, that hope for a better future. The same dream that brought John Carson's people and that grand old fiddle across the sea all those years ago.
John Carson's fiddle is silent now, an honoured relic in country music's Hall of Fame. But it still speaks to us of the people whose musical traditions can claim a proud place in the founding story of American music. In the next episode, I'll follow the story from the recording boom of the 20s to the folk revival of the 60s. And I'll trace the unbroken circle of music that still connects the new world and the old.
And you can see that next Thursday at the same time, 7 o'clock. But next tonight on BBC Two Northern Ireland, straight-talking children tell us what they love and hate in a new series, The World According to Kids.